members were outraged.
There are no automatic weapons in this building. There's nothing but a bunch of sick people and medicine for the sick and dying, but they can't go into the places where the mafiosos store their heroin and the gangs store their crack. This is an easy job for the fat, lazy cops.
The State Bureau of Narcotics Enforcement spent nearly 5 hours scouring all four floors of the building. No arrests were made because agents claimed to have been looking only for those who sell the pot, not for those who use it.
I've been smoking.
In an open act of defiance, some club members gathered outside right under the noses of the police to smoke the pot. When club members were finally allowed back in, here's what they found.
Our files are gone. Look, we had files from every doctor. They're all gone. They took our files. We had everything, all of our drawers. Look, it's just a mess what they've done. They've gone through everything and taken everything.
Some angry club members say the raid was timed to benefit prominent Republican politicians and to undercut an initiative on the November ballot that would legalize medicinal marijuana use. Drug enforcement officials deny it.
What we're doing here has nothing to do with the initiative, and we want to make sure everyone knows that what we're doing has to deal with illegal drug sales and has nothing to do with an initiative.
At a news conference, agents from the Bureau of Narcotics Enforcement say an undercover investigation showed marijuana was being sold to some people with no apparent medical need.
Some of those doctor's notes were on napkins, pieces of binder paper, and there was no attempt to check whether or not they were valid excuses.
But what about Attorney General Dan Lundgren, his recent raid on the marijuana clubs? And that was very high profile. That's bound to have some impact, isn't it?
Well, Attorney General Dan Lundgren has, for him, raiding the cannabis club in San Francisco is kind of a no-lose situation. He wants to run for governor in 2 years. He's not going to lose a lot of votes in San Francisco by doing that. He might be able to gain some votes somewhere else by saying, look, I'm cracking down on these people. He raided the cannabis club. They confiscated marijuana. They confiscated money. They confiscated records. But nobody's been busted. Nobody has come to, has been accused of a crime in this. That's an important thing to remember. The supporters of Prop 215 say this is all politics. Here's Dan Lundgren, who's signed one of the arguments against Prop 215, and he's also the person who's raiding the cannabis club, where a lot of the organization, a lot of the volunteers that are your natural base that's going to go out and knock on doors and try to get people to vote on this issue, that's where they are. So there is, you can't really get away from the politics in this issue. Dan Lundgren is an avowed opponent of Prop 215, and this is an attack that this is a fight he wanted to make.
We looked at the risk, and on one hand we have risks. We also looked at what we were doing and asked ourselves, is this something that the people in this city need?
Organizers of the distribution say they notified police and Mayor Willie Brown's office of their plans. Both voiced support.
They were alerted to it, and I don't do this in order to create difficulties for them, but what I'm doing it for is to bring about social change now.
Other ministries around the city have also expressed an interest to distribute the marijuana. Everyone knows it's against the law, but they say there's a need out there, and they're ready to fill it. In San Francisco, Linda Yee, News Center 4.
News Center 4 did call State Attorney General Dan Lundgren's office repeatedly to ask if his office is going to take any action. Thus far, we have not gotten any response to those calls.
When Prop 215 passed, law enforcement was flabbergasted. They really weren't expecting it, and it was a disaster in their opinion. The night of the election, Attorney General Dan Lundgren, California Attorney General, said, you know, we've never had a conflict like this between state and federal law. Well, the California Constitution, because of a voter initiative in 1978 called Proposition 5, it spells out what California agencies should do in the case of a conflict between state and federal law, and that is uphold the state law. But that's not what California law enforcement did after 215 passed. There was a delegation of law enforcement officials from California and from Arizona that traveled to Washington, D.C. 9 days after the passage of 215, met with then drug czar Barry McCaffrey, other department heads and staff, as well as a number of private anti-drug groups. Dr. Todd McAria asked to attend the meeting and was denied admission. One of the participants, Robert Jelinek, during the course of that meeting was quoted saying, if the other side could hear what we're doing, they'd be very upset because they were plotting to overthrow California and Arizona's medical marijuana measures by any means necessary. I've acquired three different sets of notes about what occurred in this meeting, and they all show that California law enforcement was there asking to enforce federal law, asking federal government to overturn Prop 215, asking them to deputize California law enforcement so that they could enforce federal law. They were seeking federal support to overthrow the law. And in my opinion, Barry McCaffrey played a much more sophisticated game than that. Barry McCaffrey said then, and repeatedly afterward, Prop 215 did not change federal law. They really didn't have to do anything to enforce federal law. He said at that meeting, well, let's see how this falls out, and in a year, let's take another look at it, and we'll see what we have to do. But let's not be too rash. Now, that doesn't mean they didn't respond, because over the course of the next several weeks, they came up with this action plan at the press conference they rolled out on December 30th, 1996.